There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. And I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. No, I didn't forget what day it was. Yes, I'm not dressed like I normally am. I'm incognito, which means on other days I'm out of cognito. Where do we come up with stuff like that? Who did that? Yeah. actually, I've thought about coming like this for years, partially to release an inner high school student that's hiding in there. Because, I don't know when I had to transition to wearing a tie and stuff like that, but I was a flannel shirt guy, like, forever. Winter, summer, spring, fall. And sometimes, even when I'm off duty, not presenting at home, you know, I got a snowblow, I'll throw on a flannel shirt and go snowblow. Our neighbors who dislike the winter extremely, he and I have had some humorous dialogues about it. And he told his significant other, I wonder how cold it is outside today. And she said, Pete's out in his flannel. He said, that means absolutely nothing. Yep, could be 97, could be 7, doesn't matter. It's good clothing. So I had gotten through talking about the work of these various traditions in maintaining the Jewish scripture and kind of ended on something that I wanted to spend a little bit more time on. So just real quickly, in the centuries in which the Jews came back from captivity under the leadership of Ezra and Nehemiah is when they see this first group, the Sepharim, which Deanna corrected me, and I still can't say it right, so it doesn't matter. The Sepharim came into being, and they're the ones that actually seems to have taken the Old Testament and broken it down into the groups that we still use to this day. There's the history books with a subgroup of the law. There's the poetry books, and then there's the prophecy books. And that even comes out in one of the gospel stories where Jesus is in the synagogue, and it's his turn to read. And it says they handed him the scroll of the prophet Isaiah. So they had them separated by that time. So you could actually, just like we look up a book, they could grab a scroll and have the word that had been preserved for them. The Sepharim handed it off to Talmudic traditions. The Talmud is still studied extensively by very conservative Jews. Not only is the scripture memorized, but the commentary on the scripture is memorized. And that was even starting. These things aren't like cut and dried, like on Tuesday we're going to change, you know. It's more like there's a flow and there's a movement, and one group begins to replace another group. And so even though the Talmudic scribes came into their fullness after the Romans destroyed the temple, and there was a real desire to maintain the traditions, and so they collected not only the scripture, but they collected the commentary on the scripture. But some of that, you'll notice, again, in the Gospels, one of the biggest arguments Jesus has with the Pharisees is, here's what the word says, here's what your traditions have added to it, and you obey the tradition more than the word. And so that had actually begun before it became officially a movement in the second century. And then by the fifth century, they've handed off to a group called the Masoretic Scribes, and they're the ones that we have the most information on. And we know that they were incredibly detailed. They washed themselves and they washed their clothes before they actually started to transcribe, and they were very exact in what they were doing. If they were going to write the name of God, they would actually get a new pen so that there wouldn't be a smudge or a mismark, and write the name of God. So they're the ones that we know in terms of our experience with the Western world as very strict. And so what we have is this is a picture illustration of that. We've got the original documents back in written individually. You know, you have the books of Moses, you've got the prophets, you got the history books, and they're written over about a 1,000-year period, okay? So they figure Moses wrote somewhere 1400 BC, somewhere around 450-ish, a little earlier. You've got the works of Ezra and Nehemiah being added as the last of the books of history. You've got Haggai and Zechariah and Malachi being the last of the books of the prophets being added. So there's about 1,000 years covered in the writing of the Old Testament scriptures. A historical event that occurred was that Alexander the Great conquered the known world around 310, 320 BC. And he left. He himself didn't last very long. He's one of the people that's been included in our study of Daniel. He reached a peak of power and then died, and his kingdom was divided up between four of his generals. It's wild to be a history teacher and read prophecy like that and go, oh yeah, I know who those guys are. The generals that took over Alexander's empires were all Greeks, and they brought their Greek culture and their Greek language and their Greek traditions with them as they broke up his empire. And one of them, a family by the name of Ptolemy, took over Egypt. and parts of the Middle East. And they brought their Greek attitude about learning and scholarly research with them. And they took a lot of ancient documents and they translated them into Greek out of whatever other language was the source material. And so around 250 BC, a unique translation showed up. It was the Greek Old Testament. And that actually became more the basis of what Jews who were dispersed from Israel read. The Jews who had been dispersed from Israel did not always know Hebrew, but they had been covered by this Greek culture and they knew Greek. And so many of the communities that were established in Egypt and Syria and up in Turkey, and even as far west as Greece itself, Jewish communities were created, and they oftentimes used the Septuagint as opposed to the Hebrew scripture. Kind of like the Catholic Church using the Latin Vulgate in services. They did that for centuries, even though nobody in the congregation spoke Latin anymore. If you were in a German Catholic church, you were speaking German up to the point where the priest was going to read something out of the Bible, and then he read to you from a Latin Bible, you know? And you'd go, ooh, amen, yes, that really spoke to me. So the Jews had that same kind of a tradition, you know? Maybe the higher educated, the more well-educated Jews knew Hebrew, but the common Jew was speaking Greek. And so this Greek Septuagint was a bridge for them to their culture and their traditions. A little bit later, the Masoretes take over the copying process. And basically, by 500 AD, what the Masoretes have produced in a Jewish translation is the translation that's accepted within the Jewish communities that are still going to speak Hebrew, but it's also the one that our forebearers, guys like Wycliffe, the guys who wanted to translate the Bible into the language of the common people, that was the text they had available. There was this unique thing floating around, showed up just about 100 years before Jesus was born. It's called the Samaritan Pentateuch. So two things right there. One, Samaritans. Remember those guys, right? There's the Good Samaritan, which actually is supposed to be not what you think of when you think of Samaritans. It's like the good motorcycle gang member. So the Samaritans were transplants by the Assyrians. After the Assyrians had taken out the northern kingdom, and this is how the Assyrians kept control of their empire, they would uproot a group, remove them from their homeland, take another group, uproot them, and put them in somebody else's homeland. And that way you didn't feel like dying for something that wasn't yours. That's really what it was about, okay? People fight tooth and nail to defend their own. But if you're uprooted from your own, really, is it worth dying for? No, and that's how they kept peace in the empire. So the group that they substituted in ran into all kinds of trouble. And so the Assyrian emperor found a Jewish priest and sent him into Samaria to say, teach the people the ways of the God of this land so that they'll be at peace. And the Samaritan half-breed Jewish community was born. The other thing is, it says Pentateuch. It's only the five books of Moses, because that's what the Assyrian king said. Teach them the laws of the God of this land. And so the other stuff that was connected to the Jewish heritage, the history of David, the kingdom era, the prophets that said, come back to God. None of that was translated into Samaritan. You wonder about that little maneuver. So what we have is a book of the law of Moses, these five books, Genesis through Numbers and Deuteronomy. You have these five books that were translated into Samaritan for this particular people group. And they still use that to this day. There are Samaritans in northern Israel. And they don't recognize the heritage of temple worship. They recognize sacrifices on hills, kind of like what Abraham did and probably what Moses started with, but not the temple worship. So that's kind of the paperwork of what we've got. And I want to put this on a timeline for you. So we have, we've got about 1400 BC where Moses is writing. And then you got literally a 1,000-year period where these other authors, the historians, the unknown scribes, the prophets are writing. And so somewhere, like I said, around 150 BCE, the last of the Jewish writings. You've got history with Ezra and Nehemiah. You've got Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi with the prophets. One of the things that happens, not only in this time frame, but even a little bit further, is that the Jews don't keep old documents. This is rather unique to their culture. We don't have 2,500-year-old, or maybe 4,500-year-old Hebrew documents because they burned the old documents. They viewed it as a living thing. It was the Word of God on paper, but sacred because He had spoken it. And you didn't let it rot, okay? You could let Bob's letter from downtown Jerusalem rot. You can let Uncle Micah's letter about how the sheep are doing rot. That's okay. They're just people. But the Word of God is too holy to just let it decay. And so, almost like a living thing, they would go through a funeral service and they would actually destroy the document. Now, they wouldn't wait until the last second, okay? So when it became unusable to the point where, you know, it had to be destroyed, before it was unusable, copies were made. And in fact, this was like a full, we know this from the Masoretes. We kind of assume this backwards. This was a full-time job for scribes because there's no photocopier in the boss's office, you know? There's no word processor in my laptop. So if you're going to make a copy of something, better start early. And there, we have actually uncovered in archaeological digs these rooms that were set aside. So there are like 30 or 40 people in these rooms, their own personal inkwell, their own personal writing area, and they're just copying, 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 copying. That's what they do. That's probably why some of them knew the Word of God so well, because they did nothing but copy it. And they weren't allowed to, you know, I know what the next word is. Okay? They weren't supposed to cheat and not look. They had to look back. Yes, the next word is the. The next word is hill. So they weren't allowed to do it from memory. They had to actually look back and copy and look back and copy. So very strict guidelines for this. And by the way, official scrolls for temples are not printed off at a printing press by Cambridge or Zondervan or whoever, okay? If you actually see a picture of a high Jewish ceremony, they come in with a scroll, and that scroll has been hand-copied by the scribes of this era. So within the conservative Jewish communities, they still practice this kind of destruction of the old and renewal with a copy made by humans, okay? There are, obviously, there are printed Torahs, printed Jewish books, but the official temple use scrolls are still hand copied. I mentioned the fact that one of the things that happened in there about 250 BC is the fact that the Greeks translated their Jewish scriptures, and for a long time, these were the documents we kind of had. Oh, there we go. Now, there's one exception to this burning thing, okay? There's one exception to this death thing, and that is around 100 BC, scrolls were hidden away in some caves on the edge of the Dead Sea by a community that lived there. They lived a rather separated life. They're not actually mentioned directly in the New Testament, but the Essenes were a movement within the Jewish community around this time, and their own personal writings make it look like they were waiting for a Messiah. For whatever reason, they didn't get involved in the public politics of Israel at the time that Jesus was here, and so they kind of disappeared. Their community was actually moved, I think, by the Romans when the Jews as a whole were rebelling, and occupying governments tend to have a bad habit of, hey, you're one of those guys that's given us a hard time, so we're going to move you too, even though the Essenes, there's no evidence that they participated in any of that. So the Essenes hid their scrolls, several hundred of them, and they put them away. It is assumed that they thought they were going to be able to come back for them, but they were hidden away in these cliffs, in these jars, and they kind of disappear from history for a while. But we now know the Dead Sea Scrolls gave us this piece of information that from that point, okay, from the period in which the Dead Sea Scrolls were written, which is somewhere around 100 to 150 BC, that the Jewish manuscript is set, okay? There is a faithful copying, and we didn't know that for a long time. The Masoretic text that we had from about 500 AD is the one that was used, like I said, by all the major translators. All the major translators up through the 1950s went back to a document that was only, catch this, okay? They went back to a document that technically was younger than the New Testament. And that kind of bugged folks. You know, it's like, really? We only have information. It would be like saying that we have the history of America from after the Civil War and nobody remembers what happens before that. People talk about it. There's rumors. But our real documented history of America starts after the Civil War. You'd say, well, what about all that other stuff? Or what about the guys in the Civil War were arguing over a thing called the Constitution? We don't have a copy of that? That's kind of what it was like. So the Dead Sea Scrolls are just, I've heard believers talk about them and they're concerned about them, but for me, they say that there was a faithful transmission of the Word of God that makes me trust it to a much earlier point in the history that we had. And like I told you the other day, the document analysis says that about 5% of the material was changed. And how was it changed? Well, they went from spelling of, O-V-E, to of, O-F. By the way, that's how I used to spell of, was O-V-E. So they went from, it was just simply a change in the spelling. The language changed, and so the spelling changed. But when you're talking about, even in American English, you compare our American English to our British buddies, our cousins across the lake, and if you meet a real honest Brit, they'll tell you that we don't speak English. We speak American, because they'd never claim this language as their own. So it's that kind of a, you know, we have radically different vocabulary from our British cousins. And that's only a 200-year difference. This is 1,000 years, and you're talking about they changed the spelling of a word? Not a single context of the scripture, any major idea, any theme, none of that's affected. I loosen my ray gun isn't working here. So this discovery just opens up this evidence for the foundational accuracy of particularly the Old Testament. And so, yeah, here's where I use that great word. You know, the Masoretic text is young. That's how they think about things like that. Anything that's close to us is young. Things that are farther away are older. And we've got this 95% accuracy, and that what they're talking about is it doesn't say God didn't create the heavens and the earth. You know, I mean, you're talking about a radical change if you're going to throw in something like that. And there's just nothing like that. It's astounding to me sometimes how much even the secular world was like, well, look what this proves. Well, what does it prove? It proves that they were faithful to the word for 1,000 years. And that there's no real arguable difference between what we had and what we got. So what this 1,000 years does is it pushes back the time for us being able to say how long did we have this document in our hands, that thing that I've been mentioning called providence or provenance. And the other thing that gets me is, boy, they did this without any tech support, you know? Sorry. Having a hard time. Yeah, speaking of tech support, the tech support's fantastic. My use is the issue. So we look at the tradition of holding on to this thing, and then there's one other thing that historians like to do, and that is, so, yeah, we now see that we have this line of connection. How much evidence do we have? They call that preponderance of evidence. And so what we do is we take our documents and we compare them to other documents that we have, and we say, well, you know, I have this many. How many do you have? And we look at a couple of things here. Time gap, the earliest copy, time gap, and the number. Those last three things are incredibly important. So you figure out who the author was. We examine the document. We look at when it was supposedly written. And then we look at the earliest copies. And that gives you your time gap. So if someone were to show up and say that they had a letter from me back when I was in high school, we would say, well, how many letters do you have from me? And is that the original or is that a copy? And so that allows you to actually get to the characteristic of what is authentic, okay? And so if they happen to have no copies, that they were all originals, that's a zero time gap, all right? That's pretty impressive with historical documents. It's not impressive with letters from me, but it's impressive with historical documents. By the way, we have virtually none of those, okay? We have virtually zero ancient documents that we have a copy of that it lasted all this time. We've got copies of copies, especially of the Old Testament, but even of the New Testament. We don't believe that we have an original artifact. We've got copies that were made. But we'll get to the New Testament in a little bit. So let's take a look at Moses and whoever else was involved in writing the Old Testament. And they're going to write the Hebrew Old Testament over time. Like I said before, it was written Moses did his work probably 1400 BC, and the last work was done somewhere in the 450s BC. Now, for a long time, we had the Masoretic text, 900 AD. So that gives you a 1400-year gap, and that concerns historians. 1400 years, what could you do to a document? And that's why the Dead Sea Scrolls are so cool, because they reduce that gap from 1400 years to like closer to 350. So that's an amazing jump. The other thing is, we've got 200 copies. See, there just wasn't one copy of the Old Testament in the Dead Sea Scrolls. There were multiple copies. There were multiple Isaiahs and multiple Deuteronomies and multiple Psalms. So we didn't just get one out of this treasure trove. We got hundreds. Hundreds that demonstrate very little change in the Word of God as it was transmitted from generation to generation. So here's some historical characters that we compare them to. Homer, which has nothing to do with The Simpsons. This is a Greek guy, okay? He's a Greek guy that wrote this story called the Iliad. And it was a story about a war between the Greeks and the city called Troy. He wrote it somewhere early in Greek history, about 800 BC. The earliest copy we have, is 400 BC, which means there's only about a 400-year lag time between the event and the copies. And not only that, but we have hundreds of copies. The Iliad was such a popular piece of work that it was copied and recopied and shared and recopied. Now, about a quarter of those copies come from Roman sources, and they have one major change in them. And that is, in Homer's Iliad, the Greeks slaughter the people of the city of Troy. In the Roman version, a few of those people survive and they escape and they become the ancestors to the Romans, because the Romans wanted a little street cred. Okay, they wanted to make sure that somebody said, oh, you're not just farmers, you're like dispossessed people of Troy and you're going to rebuild your empire. That's seriously what they wanted. This was politicking. So about a quarter of them have a different ending. And all the ones that have a different ending, we actually find in Roman settlements. The ones that we find in Greek settlements, the Greeks just plain win. The Roman one has this little alteration. Some other history that we compare it to. A fellow by the name of Herodotus, which is one of the first historical writers who told the story of history without trying to come up with, and then the gods got involved. Okay? He tried to take out the mythology of Greek culture and just simply say, this Greek commander thought this was a good idea, and so all the repercussions of this decision are because of the way he was thinking. So Herodias is kind of an interesting historical character, because virtually everybody before this blamed all the bad things on, you know, the gods being angry, and all the good things on the gods being happy with us. He writes about the Persian Wars, where the Greeks fought the Persians. And that happened about 450 BC. Now, catch this one, okay? You would think somebody would have kept this somewhere. The oldest copy we have of Herodias's history of the Persian War is 900 AD. So that means from the event to the earliest records, there's this huge 1,300-year gap. And on top of that, we only have about 8 copies. Yeah, we only have 8. Now, since the photocopier and the data processor was invented, we have lots, but we only have 8 copies from 900 AD. And guess what? Historians are like, whoa, this guy knows what he's talking about. This is the most accurate history of the Greek people we know. And they're like, what? You got 8 pieces of paper that tell you this story, and it's separated from the event by 1,300 years, and you think this is good? Very similar to that is another guy by the name of Thucydides, and he did the same thing. He wrote a Greek history a little bit later than Herodias, and his copy also goes to 900 AD, and so you've got 1,300 years there, and he also has only 8 copies. So this is where things sometimes bug me, okay? Because guess what? Obviously, by the rules of historical provenance and validity, Homer should win this game, okay? And a lot of historians have finally believed that Homer was writing the truth, though for a long time they thought his story was myth from A to Z, until they actually dug up the city of Troy, and then they were like, oh, he was telling the truth. It's a glorified version in which the gods are involved in all kinds of mythology, but the core of the story is true. Now, the other two guys actually have the worst, but historians say they're as accurate as all get out. So in the game of historical analysis, the power brokers look at this stuff and they say, the 3 guys on the right-hand side, they know what they're talking about. We're not sure about this other stuff. You say, come on. This is good stuff, okay? It has all the required factors of historical accuracy and transmission and integrity and validity, and you should just stop the naysaying. It's a sad truth, but it's really just a bias. There is no, quote, open mind, okay, in the academic realm. And Ted Kringa and I, we didn't have this professor at the same time, but we shared a professor that we both loved back in Oswego, a really good guy, and he specialized in teaching ancient history. That was his thing. And one of the things he taught was a Bible as literature class at Oswego. And he routinely got to the parts of the prophets and touted a line that basically said, none of the prophets wrote before any of these events occurred. They all wrote afterwards, but said they wrote before. And it's just based on the fact that they don't want to hear it. That's really what it's based on. It's just, we don't want to accept that there's historical integrity to what God did in the lives of humanity, and we just won't accept it. So it's kind of sad, but it's one of the things you're going to run into. And when you give a defense of your faith, when you give a testimony, you're going to hear the gambit of, well, I'm glad that works for you, or, well, you know, those stories can't be true. Even when I was working for a guy in lawn care in Oswego, he had been given a bunch of Bibles. He wanted me to look at them and tell him where there had been changes made. And these Bibles were old. They were like from somebody's personal family library, and they were like printing dates in the 1840s and 1860s and 1880s. And I said, well, there are no differences. And he said, there's got to be. And I said, but there's not. And he said, well, but they couldn't have printed the same thing over and over again. And I said, they did. He just wouldn't have it. It was too scary, quite honestly, because it meant that maybe something that had truth in it lasted longer than his opinion. So it was an interesting short conversation, to say the least. But God is faithful in the maintenance of his word. God is faithful in the continuity of his communication to his people. And I want you to have the ability to answer questions, but understand that even answering a question doesn't mean you're going to win the argument, because the Spirit of God has to change hearts. That's really who has to do the work in that. So if I were to start another section here, I would cut myself off. So I think we'll just call it an early day. And why don't we just close in prayer? We'll move on, get ready for the rest of our service. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for its integrity and its truthfulness, for its accuracy and its preservation. And Lord Jesus, more than any of that, we ask that you would make it alive in our lives, that we would submit to it and obey it, and that we would honor you by walking in your ways. Father, we commit the rest of our fellowship time together to you in honor and glory to your name. We pray for the worship team and their ministry, and for Kyle as he shares today. We pray these things, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.